Hi friends, this is Agnelorajesh here, chairman for St. Angelo's VNC Ventures. We are India's largest villa developers, developing villas at Thane, Chennai, Madurai, Coimbatore and Hyderabad. Advantage of buying villas with us is, we give you rental returns after you buy the villa and the maintenance is zero. You don't have to put money nor efforts to maintain the villa. Where progressive rental returns ensures that after you buy the villa, EMI or the loan repayment for the villa is offset by the rental returns that we generate. For more details, visit us on www.savvglobal.com.
In India, you know, you have a lot of challenges from the local level. When you set up a factory, the local people come and trouble you. I remember when I purchased my first factory, to get a 7, 8, 12 extract, it took me 6 months. And challenges, every day is a challenge in life. So you have to overcome it. The society has given me a lot. Today, whatever I am is because of the society. So it's my duty to give it back to the society.
Hi friends, this is Agnelorajesh here. I'm chairman for St. Angelo's VNC Ventures. And inspiring conversations is a concept which is very close to our hearts. Inspiring conversations is learning from the experiences of entrepreneurs who have been there and done that, and we learning from those experiences. Today, we are shooting the 43rd episode of Inspiring Conversations, and we all look forward for new sessions. I have a very interesting and a very inspiring guest today with us in the studio. Mr. Anirban Sarkar, a very successful entrepreneur who's been there, who's done that, who is present in many countries of this world, who has made India proud, who's a social entrepreneur and who thinks from his mind connected with his heart. So friends, let's welcome Anirban Sarkar and let's explore his journey, wherein we can learn the success anecdotes that he has achieved so that we can apply them in our lives and become successful too. Welcome to the show.
Thank you so much.
So Anirban, he comes from a defense background. His father was a squadron leader with the Indian Air Force. And he's a multilingual person, speaks 8 languages very, very fluently and is very adaptive to any language that he's interested in. So we will explore him further. So Anirban, that's a very interesting life journey that you have had. And you seem to be a very satisfied person today with the journey that you have traveled and the success that you have achieved. So as an entrepreneur, what motivated you to become an entrepreneur when you were an employee? I think you worked as an employee for almost 10 years.
Yeah.
So what motivated you to take the step of entrepreneurship?
See, I started off my career with Thermax as a management trainee. And then I moved to US. I was with Dow Chemicals. But I was not very happy working there. From my very beginning of my, when I was a student, I used to always think that why not I be an entrepreneur. And 98, I quit Dow and I came back to the country. Then I started off as a water, since I was in water treatment, I started off with a water treatment company. And of course, when I came back from between 98 and 2000, it was a very rough weather for me. Coming from a very middle class family, so it was, you know, I had a lot of problems. Many a times I used to think that why not I get back to work. That was the situation. But 2000, we got a good break in Karnataka where we got a defluoridation plant, big order in 5 districts in Karnataka. And that's how the journey started. And today, I'm very proud to tell you in 19 years, I started off in 98 and we are in 2019. It's almost 21 years now. We are a 3000 crore company. Diversified from water to solar, solar to fire. And we have a plan that by 2025, we should be at least a 5000 crore company.
Fantastic. This comes from a man who started his business with just 2000 rupees. He has worked as an employee for 10 years. He was in the US from 1992 to 1998. I would like to ask you, Anirban, what is the difference of working in the United States of America then and what happened after you started working in India? What are the initial few challenges that you faced as an entrepreneur?
So six
and how did you overcome those challenges?
So 6 years in US, basically US, if you find, or if you talk about US or Europe, it's a very organized way of business that they do, which is not there in India. We don't talk about corruptions and other things in US. It might be, but I have never seen. But in India, you know, you have a lot of challenges from the local level to when you set up a factory, the local people come and trouble you. In fact, I purchased my first factory, to get a 7, 8, 12 extract, it took me 6 months. And then, you know, getting a pollution control board certificate and other things, you know, other certification, it took me a year. So which was not there in US because it was single window. So this was the start of it. And later on, of course, you know, in India, when you come out with a new company comes, it's very difficult for them to, you know, come and establish themselves. One is the market and the other is the banking system. Banks never supported me. So I was all on my own. My 10 years of saving that I had, I started off with that. And later on, of course, banks in 2005 and all came, walked into my office and said that, okay, fine, we are here to support you. But leaving this also, we had a lot of challenges with the local people, with the local authorities, the local residents. You know, they used to come in trouble. In Marathi, we call it as Dharti Putra. They wanted jobs for themselves. So, you know, these all challenges we had and we had to overcome it. And see, I had a mindset, which when I was 6 years in US, my mindset was like
accustomed to the US.
Yes. So it was very difficult. When I came back to India, it was very difficult for me.
But you adapted so fast and so quick.
I had to. One fine day I got up and I said that if I have to be successful, I have to be an Indian.
So don't you consider that as an entry barrier, because all the people cannot manage those kind of challenges. So like they say, in some businesses, capital is the entry barrier. Probably at that point of time, after you came here and realized local challenges, I feel that would have been an anti-barrier for many people to become entrepreneurs, so they continued as employees. And that's why people like you became successful also, because you could handle and manage those challenges of day-to-day life.
See, I have a very strong willpower. And, you know, that was one of the reasons I could...
You could wait through.
Yeah, wait through. And challenges, every day is a challenge in life, whether it is in business, whether it's in any part of this, whether you're your children, your family, it's a challenge. So you have to overcome it. I overcame it.
Fantastic. So you typically work with natural resources, water and then solar and now fire. I don't know whether fire is a natural resource, but definitely it is a nature's resource. So you are having business models connected to all these three aspects. You started with your water treatment plants as your area of expertise. And then accidentally you ventured into the solar systems, because in Gadchiroli, when you wanted to put up a water treatment plant, you realized that for 18 hours there is no power. So as finding a solution, you accidentally ventured into the solar systems. So how was the decision making at that point of time when you saw that as a hurdle, as an obstacle to your implementation of the water treatment plant? How much time did it take for you to switch over to a solution where you also ventured into it as a business model in terms of solar?
See, you'll be very surprised. I'm a mechanical engineer. I'm not a chemical engineer. I started off my career with Thermax and I got my placement in water treatment division, which is related to chemical engineering. And I studied it. And fortunately for me, I had a vision that water will be a good business in future.
It's liquid gold.
Yeah, it's liquid gold. And, you know, people used to say across the world that third world war will be for water.
It is already happening everywhere.
Yeah. So I picked it up. I studied chemical engineering very well and I went into water. As you told, you were right, what we did is we had commissioned a plant in Gadchiroli, which is one of the most dangerous places in Maharashtra.
Yes.
There's a lot of Naxalite movements there. 18 hours we didn't have electricity. Now the government told us we'll pay you only if you commission the plant. Now the thing is that they said we will not give you electricity. So we started looking out for alternative energy. So we were looking out for wind. So wind is never consistent.
You need 20 years to study the wind flow.
Yes, wind velocity and other things that we studied, you cross velocity of a wind and all those things. So we thought of, there was good radiation there. So we thought of solar. That's how we came into it. I started off with a plant of around 5 kilowatt.
And today you have deployed more than 500 megawatts.
550 megawatt we have commissioned.
Fantastic.
In fact, we are one of the biggest EPC players today.
Fantastic. So your intentional business turnover is 800 crores.
Yeah.
And your accidental business turnover is 2,200 crores.
Yes.
Fantastic. So was this planned or did it just happen?
No, it didn't happen. It came with the flow. When your intentions are good, everything comes, you know, it goes with the flow. So our intentions were very good. We had good people working with us. And fortunately for me, I have people who have joined me in 2000 are still with me. So it is basically I dedicate my success to my team.
What made you get into the business of fire? What was the reason for the fire to start fire business?
See, I'll tell you what happened is I always look out for diversification. Now, fire is one sector. You will see it's not organized. You see all the sectors are organized. You talk about construction is organized. You talk about water is organized. You talk about electricity. But fire is not organized. You cannot tell me of one single company in India which is having a turnover of 1,000 crores. And it came by accident. I'll tell you of a small incident of my life.
So you are more of an accidental entrepreneur
than
an intentional entrepreneur.
Yes, it is. Now, I'll tell you, I was traveling from Bombay to Pune It was 16th of August 2011, and I told my driver, don't drive the car more than a speed of 80, and I was driving a Merc, and it was slightly drizzling. There was a car which overtook us, which was an Indigo, and there were four youngsters in it. So Kandala is a place where people come to enjoy.
Absolutely.
I need not say what was the enjoyment. So, you know, the way they were driving at 1:30, you know, my driver told me, sir, see the way they are driving. I said, if they drive like this, they will die. And you believe me, in 5 minutes, all the four died.
Wow. Was there fire in the car?
There was a fire in the car. And when their bodies, then I stood for some time. When the bodies were falling, I saw, you know, there was a small fire extinguisher which fell from the car. Then I was wondering as an engineer that when the temperature of the bonnet is 200 degrees, how will you open it? And there's so much of CO2 coming out.
Right.
Then I thought of something like which we call it as automatic fire extinguisher for cars. I started developing. 2016, we developed it. We couldn't certify it in India because there was no certification available here. We went to Europe, got a C certification. Then we got it certified in India. And fortunately, today we are doing very well with. Then we started impact fire extinguishers. Like today in India, you have those cylinders. Then you have a ball, which is CO2 based.
Mm-hmm.
See, today we talk about global warming and we talk about green. See, I am into environment. So I always think about the environment. So we started something which is water based. And we have a certification right from A to E. We have all the certifications. So now, and it's very easy to use. See, today, when we leave home, usually our parents who are aged or our children who are very small are at home. They cannot operate those things.
Absolutely.
So you need something which is user-friendly and pocket-friendly.
Okay.
India needs products which is pocket-friendly. So I developed these products, and fortunately, Sunil Shetty, who is our brand ambassador, he was very impressed with the product. And even though it's a startup, he came in, and I'm very proud to tell you, we are a 100 crore company today.
In a span of?
6 months.
So how do you make a business plan? How do you decide that this is the next business that you are going to venture in? You call yourself a startup, but there is a 3,000 crore enterprise backing up the startup. So how do you make your business plan, and how do you calculate the impact of the business that you are getting into? In terms of social impact, in terms of financial impact, it always happens that good money, the more money you make, the more are the chances of you losing it, is a saying that people say. So how do you ensure that the venture that you plan, envisage and implement does not impact the profitability of your previous enterprises? How do you do that?
See, my working system is very, very simple. Every division is a profit center by itself.
Mm-hmm.
The parent company initially helps it.
The capital.
Capital. Okay. Second thing is, see, very important is the society has given me a lot. Today, whatever I am is because of the society. So it's my duty to give it back to the society. Now, there are ways of giving it back to the society. And one way that I found is when I was doing a survey on fire, there were 1,67,000 cars which were burnt last year.
Wow.
And 4,000 people lost their lives. See, we have a problem in India. We see a news where there is a car which was on fire. We just see it and that's the end. We open a paper. Every second day there is a news. But nobody really thought about it.
Nobody reacts about what can
yes.
be done.
So I took this opportunity and I found it to be a very niche market. And I took it up. And I developed products which is can be used by a 4-year-old child, a 70-year-old man, a gentleman. Then we have people who are disabled, they can use it. So this is how I have come into the... And second thing, society has given me so much. I have got everything in life today. So it's my duty now to give back to the society. This is how I'm giving back
so
to the society.
So how do you make a financial plan, and how do you recruit a team to execute that new business financial plan?
See, I'll tell you very frankly, I have never recruited...
Do you have a sounding board where you discuss ideas?
Yes, we do have. Because, see, I don't make mistakes, I make blunders. So, always, you know, it's basically, we have a board which sits and we work it out. And I even take ideas from my driver, to be very frank to you, because he is more practical than me. So, we sit, we discuss, we have a very good CFO in the company who plans out everything. And very important is we plan out our business in such a way that, you know, if we are talking about fire, it should reach it to every shop. Availability should be there. If it is water treatment, we try to work in the rural. If you see my business, I have worked more in rural than in urban places. Even with solar, if you see, I have worked in places like Kenya, Uganda. In fact, you'll be surprised. I worked in Somalia. I worked in Iraq.
So one of your largest establishments for your business is in Africa, East Africa.
East Africa.
Fantastic.
Kenya,
fantastic.
I have a full-fledged office and I commissioned a 100 megawatt plant recently there.
So you have a workforce of 950 people working in your enterprise.
Yeah.
Amongst this 950 people, how many people are there in the top management? And what is the frequency of you people reviewing what you have done, what you are doing, and what you are planning to do?
See, we top management will be around something like 150 people.
Okay.
We are talking about people who are from president to GM level.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, senior manager you can talk about. And then we have engineers.
So your sounding board consists of how many people?
We have seven of us.
Seven of you all. Yeah. And you all, what is the frequency that you all meet to take decisions?
We meet every month. Mm-hmm. For any policy decisions, or we are decentralized. They can take
the
decision.
They have
themselves.
The power to rule,
yes,
you out?
Yeah.
Rule out on a decision that you have taken in terms of a new business or an expansion strategy. Do they have that power? Do you give them authority also along with the responsibility or only responsibility?
See, I told you, I don't make mistakes. I make blunders.
Mm-hmm.
So many a times I have made blunders. So
which
now,
was your best blunder?
Oh, many of them. I can
which
tell
is
you,
the biggest and the best one?
One of the best one, I was taking over a company in Bilaspur.
Mm-hmm.
It was a power company, which mm-hmm. They were generating power out of the hay. And we lost almost 20 crores there.
So your tuition fee was 20 crores?
Yeah, my tuition fee was...
And what were you learning out of that?
Learning out of that was, you know, get everybody together and take everybody's opinion. That was the learning. Because see, I told you, I have made a lot of mistakes in life. And I've learned from the mistake. I always say that I started with nothing. I can get back to work anytime. But that doesn't mean that I keep doing mistakes. So we have a lot of senior people in the company
mm-hmm.
who always suggest, sir, this is not the way to work. This is what we should do. And our business models are, at present, our business model are such that in past 5 years, we have all, our graph has really gone up.
So, since you are in the water business, I have got very interesting question in my mind which always disturbs me all the time. India is a country where there are places where people die because there is no water and there are places where people die because there is too much of water. According to you, what can be the water management system for the national government, for the country, where these kind of situations should not happen? Can it be the river networking? Can it be the transportation of water so that places which don't have water get water and places which have got excess water get utilized in the distribution system? What can be the solution?
See, first thing that I would like to highlight is in so many 30 years of experience in water, we don't have anything called water management in our country. First thing is that.
So there is an opportunity underlying.
Yes. Second thing is, I'll tell you, if you look at India, the eastern part of India, every year there's floods. And if you go to the western part of India, we are talking about Karnataka, some parts of Maharashtra, every year there is drought.
Drought, yes.
Now,
how to balance it?
Yes. Now, Atalji was Prime Minister, he started a concept called interlinking of rivers.
Yes.
Which the next government stopped it. That is the only solution, and water management.
So you see it happening in the near future? Because that kind of a project can also definitely become a big business opportunity for your enterprise.
For everybody.
Yes.
See, if you talk about cleaning of Ganga, that also is a big this. But I'll tell you one thing, the seriousness of the politicians. I'll tell you, it's very important for the politicians to put their foot down and they said that, okay, fine, this is what we have to do. You know, I find it very funny sometimes. Every year, the government of Maharashtra gets up and says, 20,000 crores I have given it to the farmers. And, you know, the farmers may, you know, I have exempted their loans. Is that the solution? That's not the solution. The solution is you give them water.
Don't give food to a hungry man, teach him how to fish.
Yes.
Don't give a fish
to a
hungry
man. It's very simple. And it is possible. I'll tell you, every year you are spending 20,000, 25,000 crores and this money has been recovered from somebody. Okay, this money is recovered from somebody.
It's not free money.
It's not free money. So I think, you know, the government should start working on some system where the problems are solved once for all.
Fantastic. Anirban, what kind of a leader are you? What kind of a leader do your people think that you are? How do you introduce yourself as a leader, as a business leader?
See, if you ask me as a joke, I'm a Sarkar myself.
Okay.
Okay.
No, was that an intentional surname or?
It's up to you to judge. So, you know, I'm a Sarkar. But the thing is that, you know, I don't run the company like we don't have, you know, a lot of bureaucracy in the company.
Your decision making is quick.
Very quick. And
how is your information management system in the organization?
It's good.
Because you're spread across 10 countries.
Yeah, it's good.
You're spread across multiple businesses.
It's good.
It's good.
It's good. It's very good. See, that's the reason I'm here.
So what do you consider as your strength in your journey as an entrepreneur?
See, first thing is that I have selected the right products. Water is never ending.
Absolutely.
Electricity is never ending. Fire, it's never ending, you know. Fire comes by accident.
You actually are praying to the sun god.
Yeah, we are, that's it.
With 2200 crores.
Yeah. And see, these are never ending products. I have picked up my products properly.
Properly. Fantastic.
So this is one thing that I have done. Mm-hmm. And for your information, I have just started an NBFC.
Okay.
So now we will be into finance also.
Okay.
So we will be financing for this. See, what happens is my products, like if I talk about my fire extinguisher for cars. Now today, a Ola driver cannot afford 10,000 rupees.
Perfect.
Because he is more interested ki mera diesel ho. My tires are in place. These come secondary to him. So what happens is we try to come with easy finance options. That's why we started an NBFC. And fortunately, we are very successful in that also.
Fantastic. So you have got a hand of gold. Whatever you
whatever
touch,
you say,
there is the water to support you, the sun god to bless you. Fire also works positively for you. You have made a 100 crore turnover in just 6 months. And now you are selling the easiest product to sell, money. Because everybody needs
everybody
it. It's
needs
a product
it.
Which everybody needs. Fantastic. As a social entrepreneur, what would be your message to budding entrepreneurs, mid-level entrepreneurs and successful entrepreneurs? What's your message?
See, all the three, I will tell you, this is a single message. You work hard. Wait for the right time. Failures, after every failure, there is success. I was a big failure, okay? But I didn't give up. You should never give up.
Keep pursuing what you are thinking to be right.
Yeah. And some people might be successful in 2 years, some might be in 5 years, but success will come.
How much do you believe in supporting fellow entrepreneurs for their growth?
Why not? It will be my pleasure supporting them.
So you always believe in
of
such
course,
thoughts?
Of course.
What is the next 5 years for you?
I should be in Rajya Sabha in next 5 years.
Fantastic. So in 5 years, you will be seeing Anirban Sarkar with the whichever Sarkar is there at the center. I'm sure it will be helpful to entrepreneurs like us. Anirban Sarkar, apart from doing the business in water, in solar, in the fire extinguishing business that he's got into, he's also a very avid investor in other businesses. Like he has got 4 restaurants by the name of Mi Marathi in Switzerland. He has also invested in Marathi movies. He has already produced 2 movies.
Yes.
He's producing 5 more. So that's a lot of entertainment where he'll be available. His efforts will be available in each house of the state and probably wherever Maharashtrians reside across the world. So that's a very interesting and a very aspiring and a very lively entrepreneur in Anirban Sarkar. And the subjects that he deals with are impacting the lives of not only Indians in India, but also human beings across the world, especially East and West Africa.
East and West
so
Africa.
That is Anirban Sarkar for you. That's a lovely, inspiring conversation. From 2,000 rupees to 3,000 crores as of 2018. May the turnover multiply. May he definitely become a part of Sarkar. As entrepreneurs, we have got every right to ensure that he supports your cause of entrepreneurships and helps you in becoming more successful in what you do. So I hope you enjoyed this inspiring conversations today. I hope the anecdotes that he shared with us will be implemented by all of us in the way that we do business. And we are really thankful for making India proud through entrepreneurs like Anirban Sarkar. Thank you so much for being on show.
St. Angelo's VNCT Ventures is one of the largest villa developers in India. Brings to you the White Villas Kasara. Designer Villas comes with land ownership, 360-degree lush green view, very near from Mumbai and Thane, 1.2 kilometers away from Kasara local railway station, adjoining to Mumbai-Nasik highway. Assured rentals with zero maintenance. High capital appreciation expected in coming years on this road. 20 feet double height living room. World-class materials with best amenities. So grab the opportunity and do your villa booking today. Call us on 9011223344 or visit us on www.savvglobal.com.